Hey everybody, it's Cameron Tom. I'm going to tell you all about proxies and how to use them and stuff. There are multiple meanings for the word proxy, and we're going to look at the most important ones that pertain to editing, and which ones are used for what purpose. Also, if you follow me on either of these Twitch channels, you can catch me live and we can talk about these things. It'll be fun. Trust me, it'll be fun. Now, the word proxy has different uses in different places. It can mean to be authorized to represent a person, to represent a value of something in calculation, or in web, a proxy generally acts as an intermediary between two different connections, usually for privacy or security reasons. But the main point is that every instance defines proxy as a reference for the primary thing. In video, that holds true, where the basic definition of proxy is a smaller compressed copy of higher resolution footage. This definition can be misleading though, because proxies have different applications and uses. But before we get into those, we have to understand two key terms, and those two terms are interframe and intraframe. We're going to start with intraframe because it's much easier to understand. Intraframe codecs like ProRes, DNxHR, GoPro Cineform are videos where every single frame is encoded individually, meaning every single frame is compressed and is decoded separate from every other frame. This usually results in much larger file sizes, but there's a huge benefit that comes with it, which I'll get to in a minute after we talk about interframe codecs. Interframe is the one you're likely more familiar with codecs like H.264, H.265, VP9, etc. Each of them have different compression algorithms that reduce the file size and are processed with different efficiencies. I won't go into the specific differences of those algorithms in this video because it's not necessarily important, but the key thing to note is that they all use some form of temporal compression. This means that the encoder is looking at surrounding frames to try and predict the differences of information and keep only what is necessary and throw out the rest to greatly reduce the file size. As an example, the encoder will store keyframes, also known as iframes. Let's just say it's one out of every 30 frames. If your footage is 30 frames per second, every second the codec will store one real frame, the keyframe. Then it uses that information to try and fill in the gaps between that keyframe and the next keyframe. That's the basics on how these codecs work, and just for regular playback, interframe codecs are great because they're small and they're easily transferred. However, when it comes to editing, this becomes a huge problem. Because all those in-between frames are fake, so to speak, whatever editing software you're using has to reference several surrounding frames just to try to decode one frame in order to make it modifiable. This is why the heavier the compression on the codec, the harder it is for editing software to decode it. This is also why intraframe codecs are so incredibly useful when it comes to editing. Because all the frames are independent, the editing software only has to decode one frame at a time. Now, because there are many people out there who do remote editing, it's important to note how incredibly useful smaller file sizes are to be able to transfer to other people. For example, if I have over 2 terabytes of interview footage, there's no way I'm going to be able to send that to a remote editor somewhere else in the world in a quick manner. So making H.265 or AV1 proxies so I can greatly reduce the file size to something like under 50 gigabytes, we'll say, or even lower, is crucial to ensure that I can still get footage over there that looks good and is an acceptable resolution, like compressing 4K to 1080p, but that it also gets there efficiently. Then that editor can generate intraframe proxies locally and get to editing much faster as a result. Now there's a giraffe in the room I haven't called out yet, and that would be hard drives. Data rate also plays a huge factor into whether or not your footage will actually play back smoothly. So you can have intraframe footage, but if the data rate of that footage is too fast for your hard drive to spit out, then it doesn't matter how spec'd out your PC is, it's going to lag. There are basically 2 common local types of storage that people use today, which are hard disk drives and solid state drives. To put speeds into perspective, the fastest hard disk drive in the world, made by Seagate, maxes out at 524 megabytes a second, and this is about the average speed of a solid state drive. Most hard disks will have read-write speeds that vary between 50 megabytes to 200 megabytes. And as a general rule of thumb, solid state drives are usually better for editing, hard disk drives are better for storage because they're cheaper. Now, I only wanted to touch on this subject because I'm not a storage expert by any means, but when it comes to playing back footage, storage speeds are something that's often overlooked or forgotten as a factor. So it's important to know what you're using. And just to be clear, megabytes and megabits are not the same thing. Capital B equals byte, small b equals bit, and there are 8 bits in a byte. the text will be right. Just look at where I was supposed to be pointing, not where I was actually pointing. Even if I was right, I'll probably, I don't know if I'm... Moving on. So when you see something that's 100 megabytes a second, that's roughly the same thing as 800 megabits per second. So as far as actually creating proxies, if you're editing in DaVinci Resolve like any responsible editor would, you can go up here to File, Project Settings, Master Settings, and if you scroll down, you can see you have proxy media resolution, proxy media format, and all of your settings here. You'll notice optimized media is here too, which is basically like a legacy version of proxies, but it still does have a use case, which I'll show you in a minute. But this is where you can select your codec and what resolution from the source you want it to be at. And this is usually where I select DNxHR LB for the lowest bitrate version of DNxHR I can use. Or if you're on a Mac, you can select a variant of ProRes like ProRes Proxy. It's usually the best option if you don't care about the quality as much, if you still want the interframe benefits while retaining a lower file size. There is some debate on whether or not it's worth it to do lower bitrate compressions for intraframe codecs for editing, because technically speaking, the heavier the compression, the harder it is to decode, but the performance boost is so negligible that you won't really notice a difference. I just felt like it was worth mentioning. You can also save all of these settings as a preset right up here. There's also the Blackmagic Proxy Generator app, which can run in the background, and it can be great if you just want to have it open. You can set up watch folders, and then you can drop footage into that folder, and it'll auto-generate proxies whenever it sees footage inside of that folder. And again, on a Mac, it does give you the ProRes proxy option. Now, coming back to optimized media, this is where it can have some sort of a use case. If you don't want to generate proxies of your entire clips, like let's say you had hours and hours and hours of interview footage, but you only knew you were going to use a small portion of it, you can quickly chop off the big chunks you don't need, and then generate the optimized media from there. This can save a good amount of space in the long run, but you can also do this from the Media Management tab. Now inside of this tab, there are so many things you could do. This is a course in and of itself, but you can create copies of the footage from your entire project right here, or your timeline, or specific clips that you have selected as well. But you can also transcode those clips from anywhere in this project or timelines or clips. And you have really close to the full functionality of the deliver page right here, outside of having render jobs. So you can select whatever proxy media format you want. I select my DNxHR LB. I can specify the resolution specifically. Not only that, I can see how big that size is going to be when it's done rendering. This window right here can save so much of your time. And also let me know if you want a more deep dive of this specific window right here as well. And then lastly, because I know most of you have probably seen this, under playback, you'll see where it says timeline proxy resolution. This is a bit misleading because this mostly just refers to your playback resolution and doesn't relate to the actual proxy or source media. It only affects the quality of your playback if you have heavy effects that you need to preview quicker. And hopefully this clears up anything you were confuzzled with or weren't sure about as it pertains to proxies. And don't be afraid to bang that bell or ding the thing whenever you ring the ring. No. And don't be afraid to bang that stupid bell so that it dings your phone whenever I do a thing. I also stream on Twitch on both of these channels, doing editing streams or interactive gaming streams that viewers can participate in. Definitely a place to hang out with me live, ask questions, and have fun. Definitely a place to hang out with me live, ask questions, have fun, and rant on why Fujifilm is the master race. And if you haven't tried Cutscene yet, do you even care about your sleep? No, seriously, it's not sponsored. Go check it out. It's worth it. But yeah, I'm gone. Am I a proxy?